your addiction comes and seems a little chapter one. It's difficult for me not to say Revelation. It's just like, you know, open the Bible and get to Revelation. I've been there for a year. But I'm excited about studies of other areas. Of course, we do that on Wednesday evening and Sunday afternoon. But this month, we're going to focus on the Lord's birth. Luke chapter 1. I heard about a 10-year-old that was under the tutelage of her grandmother. When it came to spiritual things, her grandmother was teaching her the Bible. This 10-year-old just seemed to gravitate to the Word of God. Loved the stories in the Bible and seemed to learn quickly. And it was really neat. It was a picture of her grandmother. She asked a question that her grandmother didn't know about. She asked this question. She said, "Which virgin is the mother of Jesus?" Grandmother, she thought she knew that for sure. She said, "I really understand your question." She said, "I'm just wondering which virgin is the mother of Jesus. Was it the Virgin Mary or was it the King James Virgin?" That's why we got to study. We got to keep studying the Bible. Luke chapter 1, if you stand with me. Luke 1. You know, earlier in this chapter, Zacharias is visited by the angel Gabriel and told that he's doing his priestly duties, and he's told that he and his wife Elizabeth are going to have a child. And it's an awesome story. I told you to read it. He later said a miracle because the well advanced in age, which I never had a ceremony, they were buried up there. They had prayed earlier. And the angel said, "God has heard your prayer." And I'm sure he's thinking, "Which prayer?" Because it's probably been a while since they prayed that particular prayer to help us to have a child. But anyway, she had a child. Of course, we knew that it was John, known as John the Baptist. And so it's the sixth month that this is set this up. So Hebrews 26 is where I began reading. And in the sixth month, that's the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to the city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came unto her and said, "The Lord is thy favor, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women." And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast out her mind, "What manner of salutation is it?" And the angel said unto her, "Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shalt call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of Christ. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and shall reign in all the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there shall be no end." Then said Mary unto the angel, "How shall this be, seeing I have no nominee?" And the angel answered, "Send her word, the Holy Ghost, said, come upon thee, and the power that he has overshadowed thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God." Thank you, be seated. I want to bring up a message. To take this opportunity to teach a little bit on the doctrine that is extremely important. The topic of this Christmas and the Trinity. We have it online, we have your bulletin. Christmas and the Trinity. In verse 31, it says, "Behold, I shall conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus." And who was Jesus? Who was Jesus? Well, if you're here and you're saved, you're born again, then you know who Jesus is. You know him. He's your Savior. He's your Lord. He's the Son of God. He is God, Emmanuel, with us. You know that. But see, the majority of the world doesn't know that. The majority of the world doesn't accept that. As a matter of fact, there's many in the world that would say, yes, Jesus, and they're like, no, if there was Jesus, that believed us, that he was a good, maybe even a great moral teacher. And that's it. And so, he said, that's one thing we should never say. That he was just a great moral teacher. He said, there's a man who was really a man who said the sort of things that Jesus said would not be a great moral teacher. He would be either a lunatic on the level of a man who says he's a ghost man, or wants you to be the devil of hell. You must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else a madman or something worse. You can shout him as a fool, you can spit at him, you can kill him as a demon. Or you can fall at his feet and tell the Lord and God. And let none of us come with a patronizing nonsense about just being a great human teacher. He has not left that open to us. He said, you're either for me or you're against me. You've got to decide. You can't just have your own way of thinking and decide that he is not God. You know, the Quran of Islam says this, and I quote, Jesus was only a messenger of Allah. That's what they conclude. Some of the New Age churches in our country say that he's a mystic medium, a channel through which you can discover the inner God in yourself. And of course, again, that is something that so many people believe in. There's a battle over this doctrine called the Trinity, the Holy Trinity. You see the teaching, and so I want to show you, I want you to study with me just a little bit. You see this teaching in the Christmas story. Look again at verse 35, and I'm going to give you a little scripture today. I want you to focused on the Trinity. Look at verse 35. So the angel actually sent the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity, to come upon thee. And the power of the Holy Ghost, that's called the Father, to preside thee. Therefore also the Holy Thing, the one that child, which shall be born of thee, shall be called the Son of God. There's Jesus, there's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, right here. Involved and we worship one God. Islam does not accept the doctrine of Trinity. Jehovah's Witnesses do not accept the doctrine of Trinity. Unitarians do not accept the doctrine of Trinity. Most false cults and false religions do not accept. They deny the doctrine of the Holy Trinity. We do not worship three gods. We worship one God, who reveals himself in three persons. When I was just a boy, and I remember this, I remember this sleepily, sitting in the front row, about 1 year old, I hate to say that. Now, the reason I'm sitting in the front row is because my parents sat in the front row. And the rule of the house, of our house, was you could sit with them or in front of them. I said in the third row, so it's the first, second, or third. And I remember three years ago, and I never seen broke that up in these animals, but I loved the hymns. I did. I mean, it's been like 5 years, I don't remember this, 6 years, seven, I don't remember this. And I sang it with all those hymns. And I still remember the first song in the 1956 Baptist hymn, which is I grew up. Anybody know? I know Susan does. Holy, holy, holy. Number one in the hymnal. So he said, turn on the light and what it was. And in that song, and again, I'm going all the way back to about 5 years old. He said, holy, holy, holy. But there's a phrase that's in it twice. God in three persons, blessed Trinity. And see, I learned this is like five God in
just come to believe how we were saved. For anything. I'm so thankful for all the kids. And we see them. We watch the kids going on. It's crazy. I know what they're being taught. It's really good to see important. I wish all parents understood that. What a wonderful attitude is this. So I want to share three truths with you. This is the first one, write down your notes. The truth of the Trinity in history. The truth of the Trinity in history. It's interesting how many people will deny the fact of the Trinity. They say they believe in the Trinity. They believe in the Trinity. What I want you to understand is the Trinity is taught and exposed in the Word of God from the beginning to the end of the Bible, all through the Bible. As a matter of fact, go ahead and turn to the first book, first verse of Genesis. Look at it. Now you can click again to the middle. Genesis 1:1. Genesis 1:1. You see that from five. It says, in the beginning, God created the earth. You see, the main God here is Elohim in Hebrew. And put this in your notes. That is plural. When you see I am at the end, that means it's plural. If you see seraph in the Bible, you know that's an angel. If you see cherub, you know that's an angel. If you see seraphim, or cherubim, you know that's plural, that's a number of angels. The same as you, this is plural for God. He said, in the beginning, God, the Father, God, the Son, God, the Holy Spirit, that was Jesus, he created the heavens and the earth. Now go down to verse 26. And God said, let us make man in our image. Oh, that's interesting. He said, let us. He didn't say, let me make man in my image. There's the Trinity. What this is triune God taking counsel together, working together in perfect harmony to create man. Turn if you will to Deuteronomy chapter 6, the fifth book of the Bible. Deuteronomy 6. And look at verse 4. This gives us an instruction. You have to wonder about this. It says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. These words which I command thee this day shall be in thy heart. A lawyer asked Jesus, what's the greatest commandment in of all? And that's why he put it right there from Deuteronomy 6, verse 4, or verse 6, verse 5, actually. But what you have here is compound unity. So put this in your notes, the Trinity speaks. Unity. It's God working with himself, among himself, in perfect harmony. And you know, don't get upset if you don't quite understand that. For instance, perplexing. You see other examples of unity in the Bible. Let me give you another one. Ephesians 5:31 is talking about a couple. Okay, let me give you another one. The Bible says, the two shall be what? One, that's compound unity. Two people in one, like one. And let me give you another example. Now, this is one that's a negative. You can call it a negative example. This is Genesis 11, verse 6. And the people were building a tower. Right? That was not God's plan. That was not God's will. He was not pleased. And he listened to what God said. He said, They're one people. They're not doing right. They're doing wrong. They're cooking together, doing the wrong thing. But that's compound unity. And you see this in the Trinity. And And you see the Trinity all through the Bible, including the Old Testament. Let me give you just a couple of examples. You remember the story, and you all talk about how the three Hebrew children, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, were thrown into the what? You have five fires, right? The king looks at it, they're bound to want to throw them there. He said, there's a looks at it, he says, well, I see four men loose, and he counted him to the loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt. And the fourth is like the Son of Darkness, and that is Jesus. He said, wait a minute, Jesus hadn't been born. He didn't get born until the New Testament. Oh, it's Jesus has always been. Always been. Here he is right there in the fiery furnace with his faithful people. Last Wednesday, I had a message to my dad that you might be able to hear about. It's just Bezalel. God commissioned him to build the tabernacle. And this is construction work, right? The Bible says, it's amazing if you read Exodus 31, the chapter Exodus 31, that the Bible says that Bezalel was filled with the Spirit. What Spirit? The Holy Spirit. You say, wait a minute, the Holy Spirit didn't come to Jesus' mouth and said, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit to send the Comforter. Well, there he is in the Old Testament. The Holy Spirit's always been. And so the Trinity has always been a little different to other Old Testament examples. Now, there's a little different from several scriptures, but I want you to pick out the Trinity as I read these scriptures in the New Testament. Matthew 3:16. It says, Jesus, when he was baptized, Jesus, when he was struck by the water, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit as a third person of God sitting on the throne of God, and he was from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, Jesus. And that's God speaking, whom I will praise. Matthew 3:18, this is the great message. Go ye therefore teach all nations, baptizing in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. John 14:26, but the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, which is the Holy Ghost, the Father, will send in my name, this is Jesus speaking, he shall teach all things of I have said to you, John 15:26, when the Comforter is come, whom I send unto the Father, he is the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me, Jesus. You see this over and over and over in the Bible. Just Peter teaching Jesus is already ascended. He's already called, he's already buried, he's already raised again, and he's already ascended to heaven. Here's Peter preaching in Acts 10:38. God anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all the oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Let me give you one more. 2 Corinthians 13:13, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. And the coming of the Holy Ghost be with you all. Amen. You see the Holy Trinity all the way from Genesis 1 to the end of the Bible, Old Testament, New Testament, working in perfect unity, unity, something, unity, liberty. So we see this truth in history. The truth of the Trinity of the Trinity is a mystery. It's a mystery. There's an amazing mystery of the Trinity. 1 Timothy 3:16 says, without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. That's the mystery. This is what he is. It tells us God is the mystery. God was manifest in the flesh. That's Jesus. That's what we celebrate. He's the mystery. God was manifest in the flesh. Just because I know, and I was given testimony here, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt. I know the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I know that's true. I know that's deep doctrine. I know sometimes.
Yeah, I feel that way.
It's because you can't exhaust the Bible.
It was just amazing.
But sanctification is unity.
We can't
really comprehend it.
John Wesley said this.
He said,
can a worm understand man?
And then he said that if a worm can understand man, then maybe you and I can understand the Trinity.
It's just beyond our understanding.
We know it by faith, but it's contrary to logic
and reason.
You think there's an account of things like that?
God never had a beginning.
What does that do to your logic?
What does that do to your reason?
He never had a beginning.
He's always been.
And don't ever get me wrong.
You seem to try to explain that.
You tell him to stand by the line.
I don't understand.
I just know it's true.
He never had a beginning.
I'll give you another one.
God is everywhere.
At the same time,
he's in heaven,
but he's here too.
He's here with us.
He's with you when you're with him.
He's everywhere.
He's omnipresent.
But we don't really understand all that.
I mean, you need to look there, maybe.
You're not there,
I'm with you.
Right?
There's all kinds of things like that we don't understand.
He knows everything
about it.
He knows everything.
He knows everything about everything.
I have to just think about it sometimes.
I have to look at things.
I look at animals and insects and whatever to get to study
about it.
He knows everything
about everything.
You've got to do
different specials
and I don't know how many hundreds of different specials,
maybe thousands.
There's specials that you know.
You're going to talk about this to him,
right? He knows everything about everything.
I accept it.
I know it. I feel that I love it.
He tried to explain it to me by comparison.
That's the way he said for me. He said,
if you love him, will you like him
die? Or with what likeness will you compare him?
You can't compare God
with anybody.
Will you compare other things?
You can compare people.
We all can do that.
You got top people, some people, five people, skating people.
Looking people.
Not just looking people.
You got
to do other people in the world.
I'm fine.
That.
You can do this, you can do that.
There's no one to tell you that.
I'm trying to do
it. It's for you.
Chairs.
You can compare one chair to another chair.
We don't have to
do chairs in our church.
You can compare
pianos,
microphones,
anything you look at,
you can compare.
Right?
You can't compare
God.
You can't compare God with anybody.
He said, when you compare him
to God,
you know what I'm saying? That
you can't see reflections
of Trinity.
All right?
For instance,
time.
It's a reflection of time.
Past time,
present time,
future.
That's a reflection
of time.
People,
we have
body,
soul,
and spirit.
I pray God you have
spirit, soul, and body.
That's all you thought about
you. So you're
triune in nature.
Your body,
soul, and spirit.
But now,
did you
just have three people sitting there?
So there's a reflection of Trinity,
but the triune
God
is a mystery.
There was an unbeliever once said,
I will believe only when I can understand
none of that mystery stuff.
If they still want people to know that's where they are,
if they can't believe,
from the body.
So I said, but then Trinity's
behind this problem.
How is it a body?
Can I have any brain
that has to do something?
He has been
a caterpillar
and upholstered
worm.
Encased itself in a great casket.
It's changed into a beautiful butterfly.
Its head changed to scales.
A calling insect becomes a flying insect.
How do you guys find that?
you for the bad karma. You planted deep in the piles of your vehicles the heap of the pressure, producing beautiful time. As things we don't understand, God knows everything about everything. He designed it. But don't feel bad if you don't understand. Write this verse down so that you know it. Isaiah 55, verse 8. Isaiah 55, 8 and 9. For your thoughts, not your thoughts. Now, my ways, your ways, saith the Lord. For the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways. And my thoughts than your thoughts. Put summary right there. Don't try to figure out everything. You have to figure God out. But I'll tell you this. He's got you figured out. He knows you. He knows everything about you. And I said this recently. Yet he still loves you. You know the way God did you. He still loves you. He did all that past. Yet he still loves you. What an amazing truth. That is, let me give you number three. The truth of the Trinity in salvation. The truth of the Trinity in salvation. Who brought the Savior into the world? Well, we just read it. One, God the Spirit, God the Father, and God the Son. They in concert together. This is the last thing to put in your notes. The ministry of the Trinity is, the ministry of the Trinity is our Savior. Why can't it's the ministry? Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. That's the good thing. That's why he came. Why was he born in Bethlehem? Why was he born a virgin? Why do we celebrate his birth? I feel sorry for people that don't celebrate his birth. So it's pagan. Are you kidding me? That's the denial. That's the denial that he was born. If he was born, a virgin, and have a perfect life, you guys can't be saved. You can be saved. Praise the Lord for his birth in Bethlehem. I'm so thankful for that. Don't forget, celebrate it. The mystery, the ministry of the Trinity is our salvation. He has chosen us in him. Ephesians 1, verse 4. We were chosen in the past, predestined for the future, accepted in the present. Years ago, when the California gold fever broke out, a man went there leaving his wife in New England with his boy. As soon as he was successful, got enough money, he sent for her. She was so happy she's now been reunited. Her and her son are going to go be with her husband in California. They boarded a Pacific steamer, sailed the way to San Francisco. But it hadn't been too long on this trip until all of a sudden you heard this all over the fire, all over the ship, fire, that's on your air, on the cross ship. Well, all along there was a power magazine, and you knew as soon as the fire hits it, it will explode, the ship will explode, everybody will perish, so they quickly got the lifeboats and people began getting on it and get away from the ship. They filled up very quickly to the last lifeboat. This woman and her son were not on board. And it was begging, please let us on it. So no man, it's full. It's full. It's no good. Please, just one more. And so we can take one more. Quickly, hurry, because she pushed her son out of the way and jumped on board. Of course not, she loved her son, she kissed her son, and she put him on that last lifeboat. And then she said this, she said, my son, if you live to see your father, tell him I died in your place. What a faint little picture of what Jesus did for you. He died for you. He died for me. And he even said this. He said, "Kill him. Come on. There's some pain to him. Go tell them what I did. Go tell them I died for them. Go spread the gospel. Go share with somebody else." let me give you one last verse in our class. This is the last verse on our set, but there's a lot more. This also has the Trinity things about salvation. It's 1 Peter 3:18. 1 Peter 3:18. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins. There's the gospel. The just, that's the Lord. So the unjust, that's you.